time. And I'm completely independent of any organisation that either commissions or provides services within Wirral. So what I'm wanting to do is to just go briefly through the annual report for the Adult Safeguarding Board. And this has been a significant period in respect of safeguarding for adults, because almost 12 months ago the Cllr Act came into force. And this was the first piece of legislation for 60 years which brought together all the various bits of law that have been concerning social care for adults. And within the Act, for the first time, adults' safeguarding boards became a statutory responsibility. And if you were to ask me where adult safeguarding is, I would say it's probably around 3 years behind children's safeguarding. And you will no doubt have seen an enormous amount of publicity in respect of safeguarding children and young people. Rather less in terms of adult safeguarding, but if I mention issues such as winterborne view, that will give you an indication of some of the concerns that come up to adult safeguarding boards. So the responsibility that the Cllr Act gives local authorities and the safeguarding boards which they have to develop are to make sure that the safeguarding arrangements among all partners are in place. We need to publish a strategic plan, an annual report, and also conduct any safeguarding adult reviews in which are defined by a clause within the Act where there are situations which would merit a review. And I think this slide is important because it illustrates that the safeguarding duties that we have apply to any adult who needs care and support, is experiencing or at risk of abuse or neglect, and is unable to protect themselves. But that responsibility extends to people, whether or not it's the local authority which is meeting any of those needs. And the reason I say that is significant, because there are declining numbers of people who are eligible for social care support funded by the public sector. Increasing numbers of people have to fund their own care. And without making any sort of judgment or comment about that, the important factor is that the Safeguarding Board has a responsibility for those individuals. The work that we do is illustrated within that diagram. And if you're looking at the slide, the groups to the right are common between the children's and the adults' safeguarding boards. And that not only produces the synergy between the two boards, but I would suggest is also a way of working much more efficiently, because it means that there will only be one meeting concerned with learning and development, for example, rather than two meetings. These graphs aren't actually as clear as I would have hoped in terms of comparing the two bar charts, but the message is that attendance at the Adult Safeguarding Board has increased over the past 12 months. And I would not only say it's increased, but I think the quality of the discussions that we have been having have, in, have improved significantly. For example, at the board that we held in December, the two significant items that we discussed were, first of all, a piece of research with John Moore's University around self-neglect, which is a growing issue, or something that has been recognised increasingly as an issue that we need to pay attention to, and also how to involve the community, people who use social care and health services in safeguarding, and also their carers. But we actually had a board seminar yesterday facilitated by somebody from a national social care organisation to plan how we can take that forward over the next 12 months. The second set of graphs concerns the numbers of people where the adult local authority designated officer, which is the what the acronym stands for, which is the person who's got the responsibility for investigating and or keeping track of investigations where there have been allegations about professionals. And that role mirrors that within children's services, again an area where it's far more developed. So the final part of the presentation really concerns the work that we have done over the past 2 years. The previous annual report covered a two-year period, the progress we've made against those objectives. And the first one of those was actually to establish, bed in the Safeguarding Adult Partnership Board, to make sure that it worked effectively, its business processes were clear, and there was actually a budget to pay for its work. The second one I've already referred to, so I won't repeat that in any great detail, but issues around working together in the match, and particularly domestic abuse, which is a common objective for both the children's and the adults' board, is important. And elected member training. I've been involved in three or four sessions with some of you, outlining both the work of safeguarding boards, but also some of the detail in respect of some of the cases that we would be concerned about and how we would work to resolve those. The next two objectives are about completing case reviews. In the slide about our statutory obligations, it says that were these requirements or the characteristics for a serious case review are met, authorities must hold one. But as a board, we have taken an approach that we've described as that learning and development, where there would be situations that are unusual, or we think there is something to learn about the way agencies can work together, but those cases haven't met that threshold, we've still conducted learning reviews in order that we can share that learning and the lessons among our partners, and particularly with frontline staff. We've got a responsibility to make sure that the entire workforce is adequately trained. Fourth objective was about making sure that we quality assure the work that we do. Not only having performance data, but making sure that there is monitoring about that data. share information over time and provide details so that we have got a good picture of how safeguarding is operating across the borough. And the fifth and I think really important element of the work of the board has actually been to produce information about safeguarding for the wider community, because it isn't just a responsibility for professionals, it's a responsibility for everyone, and that concerns raising awareness of what safeguarding adults constitutes, and more importantly how to respond to those concerns. So we've had a number of publicity initiatives, and for example, for a time I was regularly visiting Arrow Park Hospital, and if you go in there, you would see those poster boards describing what to do if you have a safeguarding concern about somebody. So that is a really important development. And to give a plug, that all things being equal, the Safeguarding Children's and Adults Board will have their own dedicated website, which is to be launched on the 1st of April. I say fingers crossed, because experience of IT developments can be that they don't go according to plan, but we are fairly confident that this will be up and running at the 1st of April. And this is the final slide, which describes the priorities of the board for this current year. And we deliberately kept the priorities to four, as we have with children's, although there are five in the children's board. Because if you have fewer priorities, you can actually pay more attention to them and make sure that effort isn't diverted or reduced. So the first is actually that for people, adults who are at risk, we can provide evidence and pay real attention to their outcomes being improved, and that they feel safe. And the best way of describing this, in a couple of these objectives, there's a reference to an initiative that's called Making Safeguarding Personal. And that was something that was piloted or promoted by the Local Government Association and the Association of Directors of Social Services probably 3 years ago, and was so significant and successful, it then became incorporated into the Care Act and within the Care Act guidance. And in a nutshell, that Making Safeguarding Personal changes the emphasis from one where previously the concern has been the extent to which we follow a process. It's more a tick box approach, that meetings have to be held within a certain time scale, that reports need to be produced to a certain standard. But actually, we weren't working with or asking the people who were subject of the safeguarding concern what it was they wanted as a result of any intervention that they were going to receive. So the emphasis, it was quite neatly summed up yesterday, has changed from a process during which there is a conversation to a conversation with people that actually includes a process as part of that. I haven't put it quite as eloquently as the presenter did yesterday. But it's all about making sure we work with people to see what it is they require or they are looking for when they are part of the safeguarding process. For example, it may be that somebody is suffering from either physical or financial abuse from a relative, but they actually don't want to be moved or lose contact with that relative. because the relative is in May, or the person who's doing the abuse may be the only person who they have any meaningful social contact with. What they are wanting is for the financial or physical abuse to stop, and we have to work with both or all parties to try and reach that outcome for the individual, rather than thinking necessarily stopping that relationship is the best way forward. We are about trying to identify need and prevention, and I've referred earlier to the self-neglect piece of work that we're doing, but hate crime is another dimension of this, and something called mate crime, which I don't know whether you are familiar with, but that is where people who maybe have special needs are being exploited by people who they would regard as their friends, and the only way they feel they can maintain this friendship is maybe by giving them money. And the way we would work with those situations is to try and explain to people that to be a friend doesn't mean that you are constantly having to give your friend money. And then the final priority is to make sure that we work across the partnerships, both with the Safeguard, the Children's Board, and the Community Safety Partnership, in order to implement fully the domestic abuse strategy, which I think is one of the top priorities for the borough. So that, in a nutshell, is the annual report of the Safeguarding Board. And the final slide just contains details of the safeguarding unit in respect of the Department of Adult Services. I'm quite happy to take questions or comments.
Hello, Mr. Walker. Thank you very much for that. It's very interesting. I'm pretty sure that we're very pleased that someone of your experience has been able to look into this. I must confess, I may have misheard, so forgive me, but I seem to recall you say that attendance had increased, when in fact I notice it's actually decreased and non-attendance has also increased. So given that, and the fact that it links into your objective 5 about getting out there with communication and engagement, I was just a bit curious, is there a dashboard that sits behind these objectives where you have a minimum standard of attendance that you're expecting? Because obviously there's a budget that sits behind this.
And yes.
I was wondering if you had in your head or in the dashboard what that minimum would be.
Attendance at board meetings or attendance at safeguarding case conferences, review strategy meetings.
Well, let's go with both.
Okay. Certainly there is a requirement within the procedure for attendance of officers at strategy safeguarding review meetings, and that is one of the things that the performance panel would look at and report. And the way that operates is a lot of the work of the safeguarding board takes place through the subcommittees, who report to an executive group who really scrutinise the detail of the data that we would receive. And I think that's one of the pieces of work we've been involved with over the past 2 years, is improving the quality of the data, and also that we've got confidence in its accuracy. And that, I think, is being improved, will be improved significantly now that the liquid logic scheme, which you may be familiar with, has been implemented across the council. In respect of the attendance at the board, I did say I think that the graphs are slightly misleading because they've got different numbers on the left-hand side, so you're not necessarily comparing like with like from memory. if it's the graphs illustrate that the attendance is reducing, is less than it was. If so, it's only marginal. And I think the important thing is the quality of the debate and the quality of the reports. I mean, as a chair, my performance indicator is that everybody who attends a meeting makes a contribution. I don't want 15 people round the table and only 3 people talking. And I actually think the quality of the debate has improved, particularly through Health Watch your regular attendance. The Old People's Parliament make a good contribution to the board, and I think that is important. So I mean, my subjective judgment would be that the debate has improved over the last 12 months.
Okay, Angela, and then
okay, I just wanted to ask about BLR data. So, looking at the referrals in March 2015, there was a really big hike to 22 that month. And previously, if you look at the referrals from the previous year, the highest number of referrals that month was 14. And I can see that kind of April 2015 to March 2014 to March 2015 is a bit bumpy, but there's that quite significant spike there in March. And I was just wondering if kind of that had been looked at. Has that continued kind of through the rest of last year? Is it been because of a particular piece of work that has been done about kind of raising the profile about the referrals?
That is the sort of analysis that the performance group would do, and that would be considered by the executive. And I mean, you could argue it is a good thing that there are increased numbers of referrals, because that indicates, as you say, raised awareness of both what safeguarding constitutes, but also organisations' responsibilities to refer complaints about professionals through to the ladder, as it's termed. And that's why I'm saying I think we are probably 3 years behind children's safeguarding in the way these systems are developing in respect of adults. But certainly that's something that we keep a vigilant eye on, and we'll do that every quarter.
Thank you. Alan?
Yeah, just a quickie. One of your objectives was that the workforce is adequately trained. For this purpose, how do you define workforce?
We define anybody who works in adult social care or health, or also within the voluntary sector, because we need to recognise that the vast majority, certainly in social care, is provided through the independent and voluntary sector. So we have a responsibility to make sure that staff there are adequately trained. This always was, and I'm not sure the up-to-date position, I've no reason to assume that it isn't, monitored by an organisation called Skills for Care, which is the Sector Skills Council for Social Care, and each local authority, certainly when I was a director, was required to provide information for what was termed the minimum data set, which provided information about staff and also their training. So it's important we recognise that this extends to all staff, particularly in areas where there could be a high turnover of staff, and there's been considerable national publicity about this in the social care sector. But certainly there are common induction standards that providers need to make sure that they adhere to.
Okay, I've got two more, if you
look
around. I've got Treena and then
thanks, Ben. And just following on to what you were saying then about the training for the voluntary sector, we've got quite a lot of friends groups in our ward. When is this likely to start, do you think, commence the training?
The training is and they are always present, and they're at a senior level. So if any of those organisations weren't attending in the way that I felt they should be, then it's my duty to contact the relevant chief officer of that organisation. Now, we've never got to that stage because the people from the CCG, for example, Lorna Quigley from the CCG, is a regular attender, and I meet with her outside of the meetings. So each of the key organisations are there. The police are always represented at the senior level. I mean, Vicky attends from council's legal services. So some of the people who maybe don't attend are, for example, I'm not picking on anybody in particular, but just off the top of the head, you've got some of the voluntary sector people may or may not come. Sometimes some of the organisations now, for example, NHS England, it used to be an office that covered five boards, I think. Since they amalgamated to cover Cheshire and Mersey, the people there have to cover 12 boards. So you can't guarantee that they will always be there. But if there was an issue, we've got links with them. So I can give you assurance that I think people do attend at the right level, and if they don't attend, we could pick that up. I mean, what, for example, we've just recently, in the last 12 months, got somebody to join us from the independent sector domiciliary care providers, and she has made a really good contribution over the past three meetings, and actually is at the workshop yesterday, and I thought made some really really valuable points.
I mean, my concern would be, because you're not getting full attendance, that may have happened to the board, but it's what it's meant to be doing, if you give assurance that's not the case.
Yeah, my assurance that I was concerned about any organisation, I would raise that with the organisation's concern. And as part of my role, it's not just choreographing meetings to make sure that they operate effectively. In the days that I have associated with this role, I try and do three things. Liaise with senior people from the various organisations, and for example, I meet with the Chief Executive of the Council quarterly to discuss safeguarding. To make sure that I get as much contact as I can with frontline staff in the organisation. So I've visited the community trust, I visited the mental health trust, I visited the acute trust during the course of the year. And then finally, I have some involvement and contact with user carer groups and organisations. I mean, I couldn't claim in the limited time that I have that is a massive range of visits that I do. But I do have a sort of work programme each quarter that tries to cover those elements.
Okay. Can I say thanks very much for
that? It's a pleasure.
Always. And I have members know that the course was ended up on the but I'll see that British knows that presentation of course again.
Okay, thank you.
The next item is the one I moved off the agenda, which is meeting the housing needs of vulnerable people. And I think we've got a whole array of people on this one, haven't we? Cast of thousands.
Mm-hmm. You okay with this here?
Yeah. Speaker, I believe. Okay, so you're going to do the presentation, Jim?
Yeah, we haven't sent the presentation, though. We're going to talk to you today. Okay.
You'll have to raise your voice a little.
We were asked to come and provide a paper for you about housing needs of vulnerable adults. So, and what I won't read you through word for word, but what we've included in there housing for people, extra care housing for people who've been assessed as needing additional needs or support from adult social services department. So the paper kind of describes that range of services that the council has got provisions to deliver that. Do you want to say a bit about the services that you've got permission from housing?
We have up to about 5,000 people at any one time. Can you all hear me? Sorry. Up to any one time, we have about 5,000 people who have supported to live independently through what we call housing support services. So the majority of those will be 4,000 of those clients will be sheltered housing residents who live in the sheltered housing schemes and we support those. But we still have a considerable amount of services for socially excluded groups, so for instance homelessness clients, young people at risk, people with offending behaviour, drug and alcohol use, misuse, people fleeing domestic abuse, and recently we've been involved in joint bids around increasing provision for women fleeing domestic abuse accommodation services, and we work with partners to develop some of those services, but we do at any one time keep up to 5,000 individuals supported in low level housing aid support services within the community.
A range of supports as well overall that we provide to people obviously who are classified as vulnerable that council obviously support, and that can also be around helping them maintain to stay in their own homes through disabled facilities grants. We also have very specialist panels that we look around rehousing for more vulnerable people, like people learning disabilities clients. We have the extra care panel as well. But we also obviously have very bespoke, specific meetings around rehousing, perhaps those individuals that are, like she alluded to, who are offending as well. So we'll have the low-level support services going in, but matching the housing together as well. So that's the most appropriate place.
Okay, I know you want to ask a question. I asked this report for a particular reason, and that was to address the issue of extra care housing. I'm looking at the extra care housing requirements here, which says you've got a capital allocation for maybe and a target of 150 extra care housing places to be provided by 2017. Now, I don't think we've had any extra care housing for several years now, and that is the big concern. I think everybody in this room could probably say we know a nice piece of land in our ward that would do for extra care housing, but it doesn't seem to be happening, and that is a big concern, because we're doing a piece of work on avoidable hospital admissions, and one of the most important things is obviously getting the right sort of housing for people, and extra care housing would help that situation in avoiding hospital admissions enormously, but it doesn't seem to happen. And can you able in a
sure.
And then I'll ask Janette
if you want to ask questions. We've probably got five extra care housing schemes, 191 places that are mostly for older people, in four schemes spread across the borough, and one scheme that's 10 places that's specific for dementia specific extra care. We have, over the last 18 months, 2 years, put together a framework of registered providers to help us work strategically with us, with our partners in housing, to help us to deliver extra care housing. We currently have two schemes that have been into planning, and one for Barncroft that's been in development with Magenta.
Where would that have been?
It went through, I think, in December, and it was due to be finalised.
To locate
Pensley. Yeah, Pensley. But there are some challenges in delivering extra care, not just in terms of availability of site or capital, but there are big challenges in terms of rent levels and changes to the welfare benefit system that will have a big impact on registered providers in terms of their ability to build, sustain and finance schemes in the longer term. So some of the, as an example, some of the things that came out of the autumn statement, the Chancellor for registered housing providers, they've been required to have a 4-year, year-on-year 1% reduction in rent levels. We've had the introduction of the bedroom tax that's had a big impact on housing.
was basically been put more emphasis on them using their own assets and their own rental income to support capital programme bids for new builds. What's happened is, because of the reduction, that nationally most registered providers are, have seriously obviously looked at their business plans, and it has affected their ability to actually develop and do growth in the areas, and then to the extent that they were planning to do over their five, 10-year business planning process. And what's happened is some of them are more able to absorb that and are still planning to do growth and to do developments, but they are having to, we basically just had a meeting with the HCA this afternoon, the Homes and Communities Agency, and there is still a massive debate. The next parliamentary discussion on it is on the 27th of January, is the new implications that's come out around the capping of social rents to local housing allowance rates. Now, at the moment, it includes all supported housing, all general needs. There's no indication and no sort of any guidance been given around whether there's going to be any exemptions to that. So at the moment, the HCA actually confirmed to us before that all those extra care schemes and supported housing schemes nationally that were due to either go on site, all registered providers have stopped proceeding with those schemes until the government releases certain guidance on the application.
150 by 270 is absolutely notional.
Up until the autumn statement, it wasn't notional. But yeah, it's the new things that have come out at the end of November that will definitely have a very negative impact on us being able to deliver those things then.
I've got Janette first.
Thanks, Janette. Thanks for being here. I've been quite out. Drastic, dire the applicants. But I just wanted to come to the issue of domestic abuse. And now I know we've got a refuge, and that is like for the most sort of serious cases where women are literally fear for their lives and have to flee. Do you have anything in place like a tier below that where women can go and sort of set up homes somewhere where they're safe but they don't require